everyone. I'm Mr. Gabe.
And I'm Mr. Andrew.
And this is
An Epic Story! Cue the music!
Today we'll be talking about the very first king of Israel.
The very first king of cereal is the Breakfast of Champions! Wait, did this guy have like a castle made of Cocoa Puffs? Oh, did he have like a moat that was made of milk? Or was the drawbridge made of a giant spoon? And he had a Frosted Flakes for a crown! And maybe he even had a robe of like Fruity Pebbles, and Lucky Charms could be the money! But not the gross part of the cereal, because that's but just maybe the marshmallows, because that's the only part I actually
eat. Okay, slow down. This guy wasn't the king of cereal, he was the king of Israel. You know, God's people.
Oh, I gotcha.
God's people decided that they needed a king, so they asked God for one. Before this, they'd been ruled and helped by people called judges.
Order! Order in the court!
What are you doing?
Overruled!
Do you even know what that means?
It means that I'm in charge, duh. Now listen here, before I put you in contempt. Objection, overruled, sustained.
Approach the bench. I got in trouble.
The judges in the Bible were not like today's judges at all.
They weren't?
No, these judges were chosen by God and helped tell the people what he said. Like a woman named Deborah or that guy Samson with the cool hair.
$998, $999, $100. Sorry, Gabe, but perfect hair like this doesn't just happen. You need this more than me.
Thanks. The Israelites really wanted a king to help them defeat their enemies. So God answered them by sending his prophet Samuel to anoint a man named Saul. This guy even looked the part of a king. He was tall.
You know what? Height isn't everything, Gabe. You run the risk of hitting your head on things like, tables.
He was strong.
Oh. Look at the muscle.
And the Bible even says he was handsome.
So if these are the requirements, I could basically be a king. I mean, come on, look at this thing.
Saul made a great king. It seemed to be going really well. He was strong and brave and fought and won tons of battles.
I am a mighty warrior!
But the real secret to Saul's success was Samuel. Samuel was there to help him go God's way.
So like he was giving directions.
Yeah.
Like Siri.
Wait, no. That's...
Make a left-hand turn. Continue straight for 6 miles. Turn right! Please proceed to the route. Make an immediate U-turn.
So...
Now! Proceed to the route.
So...
Make a U-turn now. Please proceed to the route. Gabe, make a U-turn now!
Are you done?
Have we reached the destination yet? Make a right-hand turn. In 800 feet, your destination will be on your... Calculating.
I'm so sorry, man. I have no service in this place.
Left.
So...
You have arrived.
So everything was going great until one day, Saul was with his army getting ready to fight in a huge battle. Saul had known this battle was coming, so he'd gotten his army together and prepared them for the fight.
Put me in, coach!
Their enemies, the Philistines, were coming for them with a massive army.
I'm ready!
Saul was waiting for Samuel. Before they could fight, Samuel would make a sacrifice to God. And that might sound weird to us, because we don't do this anymore, but this was normal for God's people. They would make sacrifices as part of their worship to God. But a very important rule about the sacrifice was that only the priest could do it.
What?! That's like when my mom says that she's the only one who can use the blender. She tells me, Andrew, you're not Chef Caden.
Andrew.
Or when my mom says she's the only one that can cut my sister's hair. I did it the one time, and the bald spot, it didn't even look that bad.
Okay, you should never cut your sister's hair again, but show me a picture later. Yeah. So in this story, the person allowed to make the sacrifice would be Samuel. God told Saul to wait for him, but Samuel took a long time to get there. They would get up ready to fight, but Samuel still wasn't there. And they would check for Samuel, but he still wasn't there. Saul and his army were waiting and waiting and waiting.
Come on, I just really want to fight already!
They waited for an entire week for Samuel to show up, but one by one the soldiers got tired of waiting, and finally they decided to leave. More and more soldiers left until most of the men were gone.
You quitters!
You need to wait. Saul looked around and saw that he had lost almost all of his army. And he became very afraid. How is he supposed to fight this battle without his army? And how am I supposed to tell this epic story with you doing that behind me? He felt like he needed to do something, so he decided to make the sacrifice himself without Samuel.
Ooh, Saul did something he wasn't supposed to! He should get in trouble, like lose his video game privileges.
Andrew, what are you doing? They didn't have video games, it's the Bible times.
I'm so sorry, I keep forgetting, it's a force of habit.
Saul disobeyed God, but was the sacrifice a bad thing? No, not at all. Making a sacrifice was a good thing. It was worshiping God. But Saul did it his own way because he was afraid. He had the wrong heart.
He had the wrong heart? Whose heart was it? How did it get there? And was it like Frankenstein's? Where is the right heart? Is there a doctor in the house?
Andrew, no, he...
Fine. I hoped it wouldn't have to come to this. Dr. Andrew is in the house!
Andrew, hold on!
Stand back, Gabe! I have absolutely no training, and I have no idea what I'm doing. Clearly, he needs me! 2016, the glucose stat!
This is all you have?
This is perfect.
Wait, what are we doing? Saul's heart is fine.
But you said...
I meant he had the wrong heart behind what he was doing. Not literally he had the wrong heart.
You're gonna be okay!
Saul wasn't trying to worship and serve God. He was just trying to get God to do something for him.
Like when I tell my sister if she cleans my room, then I'll take out the trash for her.
Yeah.
But then I actually take it and I hide it under her bed and she can't figure out why her room smells. She's like, why does my room smell? It makes no sense! It's hilarious!
Andrew, you did what? Kids, do not do that. Samuel told Saul that because of his decision to go his own way, he wasn't going to be king for much longer, and that God was now looking for someone new to rule, someone after God's own heart.
I've heard this phrase before, but where did I hear that from?
From that moment on, Saul's army would follow him, saying, "Do what seems good to you, not do what God is saying." Saul continued to fight many battles, and Samuel was there to try and guide King Saul the right way, God's way.
Turn left, here.
But Saul had to be the one to make the right choice. One day, Saul's enemies, the Amalekites, were getting ready to attack, and he needed to fight this battle.
Huzzah! God save the queen!
Or Saul. God sent Samuel a message to tell Saul that he would win the coming battle, and then when he won the battle, he needed to destroy everything and take nothing back with him. So they went to battle. When the battle came, God was right. The Israelites won. But then Saul decided to let his people take things from the Amalekites. Saul didn't go God's way. He chose his own way again.
Saul! Please proceed to the root! You're doing it wrong!
Obviously, this isn't what God wanted Saul to do. Samuel caught up with Saul after the battle and asked him why he took those things from the Amalekites. Saul said that he was afraid of his own people.
Oh, my bad.
Saul cared more about what the people thought than what God said. He did something that he knew was wrong so the people would love him. Instead of looking to God, Saul had a bad heart.
Not again! Spatula!
No. The Bible even says that the Lord regretted making Saul king over Israel. Samuel had a new mission from God, to find a new king, someone after God's own heart.
Wait a second! There it is again! That's gonna bother me. I feel like I know I've heard that phrase before, but where? Is it on a carton of cereal? Milk?
And that's an epic story.